I'm sorry, Lord Rosmer said,
Mooney's grave face having recalled him to the seriousness of the detective's mission.
But, you see, if there had been the slightest likelihood of a murder at the second conference, it would be Sir Robert who would have committed it, for it was Sir Robert who left me vowing vengeance against the person he was presently to see.
And that person was?
That person was Miss Pritt, his confidential secretary, whom he had accused quite absurdly and without the slightest foundation of having betrayed him to...
Lord Roseborough stopped abruptly, having realized that he had already said too much. His enemies, Mooney completed the sentence. The superintendent still kept that mask of imperturbable gravity which screened his thoughts very effectively, but there now appeared in his eyes a hard, determined look in which his decision to probe the mystery of Sir Robert's murder to the very bottom could be quite plainly read. His enemies, he repeated, who had demanded his resignation from the board of directors of the Industrial Development Trust and who had agreed to a compromise which would have deprived him of his sole control of the Trust's affairs, only after they had assured themselves that his confidential secretary, in whose loyalty he trusted and whom he insisted on being given an executive post with the Trust, was on their side. The last spark of merriment died out of Lord Rosebery's eyes with a suddenness which was in itself sufficient to show the panic into which he was thrown. Those high-pitched notes in his laughter a few minutes ago, which seemed so out of tune with his general hale and hearty appearance, were symptomatic of the nervous tension under which he laboured. He looked at Mooney, half in terror and half in rage. His face, which had turned deadly pale at the mention of the demand for Sir Robert's resignation, almost at once recovered its colour, but his eyes narrowed and his lower jaw was thrust forward. His fighting nature reasserted itself over his weak nerves.